between us, God with us, God for us. Nothing could come against, no one could stand between us.
I want to shift a little bit. I have a guest here that I would like to bring up to share right now. I want you to just, she's going to bless us in a mighty way right now. I want you to welcome to the stage Shayna Wilson Williams. Right?
God, there is nothing too hard for you, Lord. Oh, we bless your name, we bless your name, we bless your name, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Welcome to the promise today. Don't it feel good in the house of the Lord? Amen, amen. If you have a need today, let me see your hand. If you have a need in this place, we're getting ready to pray. I was reminded as soon as I began to pray in the prayer room today of a scripture. In Ephesians 3:20, Paul said, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. According to, that's very important in this scripture. According to the power that worketh in us. First of all, today, there is nothing that God cannot do. I want everybody to know that He is able. And no matter what the situation is, we should never measure our problems based on our ability. No matter the need, no matter the situation, no matter the circumstance, whatever that is, we should measure that based on who is doing the work. If there's a problem in our world today, I want to know who's doing the work before I determine how hard it is. If we needed to move this pew this afternoon, I can assure you that I could do a better job of that than Sister Sherry. Not knocking her, because she could do it. She could do it, but I could do better than she could. If you needed advice today about this life's journey, I can assure you that she could give you better advice than I could. I could give you advice, but it wouldn't be as good as the advice she would give you. But no matter the need, no matter the situation today, you have a God on your side, and He is able to do everything. Anything you can ask or think of, your wildest imagination is only beginning to tap in to the capability of our God and the power that is on your side working inside of us. And if you believe that He can today, let's all pray for every need that went up today. God, we love You. Lord, we know that You are able and You are willing. God, we ask that You would come into this place, Lord, and touch every need and every situation. God, we are trusting in You, God, as our provider. You are the way maker, Lord. You can make a way when there seems to be no way. God, every hand that went up, Lord, whether it's a sickness or a financial situation or a mental problem or a struggle, God, I pray that You would move in this house, God, on every person that's here. I pray that somebody will leave different than how they walked into this room today. God, have Your way. Send us a message from the throne room of heaven today. God, bless us in this place. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray.
My hallelujah belongs. Oh, yes, it does. My hallelujah. Say, my hallelujah belongs. Oh, my hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs. Now say You deserve it.
Yeah.
say you deserve it, God.
You deserve it.
Yes, you do.
You deserve it.
Yeah.
You deserve it.
Testimony service might have broke out. Let's say it again. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
That's from my heart, oh God. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Come on now, however you want to do it. You give him your praise right now. God, we thank you. Oh, God, we thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God, you deserve it. From the rising of the sun to the sun goes down, you deserve it. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We love you tonight, Jesus. We love you this afternoon, Jesus. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Man, it feels good in the house tonight. Feel the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Amen. Come on, let's give Jesus a big praise tonight. Hallelujah. We bless your name. We praise you, Jesus. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're able to be here. You're the reason we want to be here. You deserve it. You deserve it. We could never repay you. You deserve it. You deserve it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. What a beautiful congregation of people here this afternoon to worship and praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Feel so wonderful in the house of the Lord today. We want to say welcome to each and every one of you. We are delighted that you are here this afternoon at the Promise Apostolic Church. Praise God. Amen. I just feel something wonderful moving among us this afternoon. But welcome, welcome, welcome. And we want to say a very special welcome to Brother Anthony, Sister Kelly McCool. We are delighted
that I would like
with us tonight. We are excited. This family means so much to us. Bishop and Sister McCool, or someone like myself who has been in this apostolic message and this way and this truth for all my life. You just can't imagine how much Bishop and Sister McCool mean to us. And then Pastor Mark, Sister Jamie McCool, tremendous friends of ours. I said not too long ago in his presence, he and Brother Carpenter were my role models. I looked to them. I watched them from afar. I learned so much from them. Still am learning and gleaning from their leadership and their ministries. And we're so thankful. The pews you're sitting on, Sister Kelly, do those feel familiar? Feel at home tonight. Amen. We're so grateful to the McCools for blessing our church with these wonderful pews that you're sitting on tonight. And just to give you a real quick little story about how wide the ministry of First Apostolic Church reaches. We were in South Carolina a few weeks ago, and we have a business there, and we were carrying some stuff into the building. And the lady that manages that business for us, she said, "My husband will be here in just a little while." And when he arrived, after about 5 minutes, he said, "She tells me that you all are apostolic." And I said, "Certainly we are." And he said, "Do you know Pastor Mark McCool and Bishop Billy McCool?" And I said, "Yeah, I do." And he said, "Pastor Mark McCool baptized me when I was just a little boy, and I grew up and spent a lot of years at First Apostolic in Knoxville, Tennessee." And what a just tremendous thing. That just gave us so much to talk about. We reminisced, and just a beautiful thing. But we appreciate the ministry of First Apostolic Church in Knoxville, Tennessee. Amen. I want to take just a moment and thank Brother Chris Crawford. Brother Chris is in our media department. Brother Chris has been doing a lot of work on our website. Some tremendous work. He has helped us to get our live stream on the website. So for anyone who is shut in and unable to be with us, or for those of you that even want to go back later and watch, our service can be watched live from our website, and then the services are archived there now. We thank God for that. You can go to the website and watch any of the past services. So Brother Chris has done a tremendous job there. Yes, he deserves it. He also has an updated calendar on our website. If you want to look and see if anything's going on this month when you're planning your vacations or trips, you don't want to double book something, we're going to be working very hard. Brother Chris is the tip of the spear, so to speak, on that. So you can go to the website and see what's upcoming in the near future, in the next few months, on our church calendar. Brother Chris, again, thank you so much for that hard work. Wednesday night, Refuel, coming up in just about 3 days. We're excited about being here. Our children's program, our teens have been spending a lot of time with our pastor, establishing them in this great truth. And then the Bible class, we're going to resume our Bible study series we're doing here called The Master Sculptor. We'll be here Wednesday night, so make that effort. I know it's hard to get home from work and eat supper and get ready and come to church. I know that it's difficult, but when you make that effort, God will reward you greatly, and it will give you fuel to just propel yourself spiritually through the rest of the week. There's a lot of great things coming up, too many to mention, in the months of May and June and July, but we're excited and glad to be busy for the kingdom of God. Would you put your hands together right now and welcome our pastor as he comes to greet you?
Let's give that to the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Amen. Come on. Let's magnify Him. Amen. Thank you, Lord. We praise you today. You are great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to Him. Amen. He deserves it. Amen. He deserves it. Thank you, Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." And we're so glad to be here. It feels so good in the house of God today. So glad to see all of you here this afternoon. I got a message online this week, and I want to share the contents with you about that message. A family has been visiting our church for some time, and I got a message this week that Brother Jonathan Coffey and his wife and children would like to make the promise their home. Welcome. We're honored that you would consider us. Amen. Isn't that awesome? Amen. Our family just keeps getting bigger and bigger. Amen. Thank God. Amen. So we're so excited about that. Of course, when somebody's been here three times, we just claim you anyway. But we're so honored to have such an awesome family join our family. And he's a very talented musician, and I'm sure that we'll be able to utilize that as we go forward. But we're so glad to have you be a part of our church family. And there's my friend Alex Lawson. Made my day. I'm glad to see you here this afternoon. And I saw an old friend of mine come in a minute ago. Now, my eyes are playing tricks on me these days. I'm getting older. But is that Jerry Smith back there? Wow. We're honored to have you. Welcome him today. Excited to have you in service with us this afternoon. I've known him for many, many years. We're so glad he's here. And I hope I don't overlook anybody. Jake, glad you're here. That's a friend of my boys. He stole my truck. Didn't steal it. He bought it from me. I want it back, though. But we're glad he's here and glad to see all of you that chose to be in the house of the Lord today. And we go on and on about our guests, but I want you to know that if you are among the faithful, you are so appreciated here at this church. And we're so glad to see all of you here today. We're going to ask our ushers to come. We're going to receive your tithes and offering unto the Lord. Boy, it's warm in here, isn't it? You never know what to set the thing on. You know, it's winter one day and summer the next. It's hard to keep up with it. But we'll try to get it cooled off here as quickly as possible. We will, again, have our middle section to march. And we'll, Brother Larry and I are trying to figure out a way. We need somebody with an abacus and a calculator and any other kind of scientific something other to figure out a way to march. But anyway, our middle section will march, and then after we pray, the two side sections, you can be seated and we'll pass the plate. Brother Greg Craddock, would you ask God to bless our tithes and our offering? Amen and amen.
Jesus, you It's goodbye to sin and things that confound. None of this world shall turn me around. Daily I'm working, I'm working. And glory to God, I'm going. Yeah, He set me free, yes, He set me free. And He broke the bonds of prison for me. Yeah, I'm glory bound by Jesus to see. Oh, glory to God, He set me free. I know that He set me free, yes, He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound by Jesus. One more time, I know that He set me free, yes, He set me free, and He broke the bonds of prison for me. Yeah, I'm glory bound by Jesus, see, for glory to God.
Last time,
I know that He set me free, yes, He set me free, and He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound by Jesus, you see. For glory to God, He set me free.
If you're glad to be set free, why don't you put your hands together for the Lord one more time.
Kind of getting settled. You can be seated if you'd like. You can stand if you'd like. I'm going to stand, so you could if you want to. While we're all getting settled back in, a lot's been said about the McCool family. We are so thankful. Brother Anthony, Sister Kelly, just wonderful people. Man, just great. Without a last name like they have that has a little notoriety, they'd be just as fantastic. But Brother Anthony is a wonderful. I appreciate he's given his life to study. And is just learning and learning. Got all kind. He's got more degrees than we have in this sanctuary right now. I think it's hot, but he's got more degrees than whatever we've got going. Sister Kelly's just a wonderful singer. She's not going to do that for us today, despite my arm twisting. But man, they're just great people. We're so thankful to have them. But let's all worship together. We're all at home in the sanctuary today, aren't we? Let's praise the Lord all together. More song. Thank you, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, take all that I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire. Oh, set me on fire. Everybody say, take all that I have in these hands and multiply,
multiply,
God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire,
oh,
set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open.
Yeah, God.
Pouring out my life, gracefully broken.
the end, you will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me.
You will be with me.
Yeah,
here I am, God, with arms wide open. Pouring out my life, gracefully broken. Pouring out my life, gracefully broken.
Everybody say this.
Say all to Jesus now.
Come on, give all to Jesus.
All to Jesus now.
Say, I'm holding nothing back.
Holding nothing back. Holding nothing
back. Now say, I surrender.
I surrender. I surrender. I surrender.
Give the Lord a big praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's take just a few seconds here and praise Him. Love on Him a little bit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we bless your name today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Brother Ben and musicians and our praise team. So thankful. We got the best. We're so thankful for them. Appreciate them so very, very much. And I want to remind you, how many high school seniors do we have? If you'd just lift your hand. High school seniors. Several. I want to remind you, Brother Chris Crawford needs to speak with you. Everybody know who Brother Chris Crawford is, right? He's sitting right back there. He's standing up back there in that pretty blue coat. Looks like a car salesman. Nothing wrong with car salesman, Brother Coffee.
Brother Ratliff.
John Loveless. He needs to see you about some pictures. We take a service each year to honor our graduating seniors, and so we want to put together as great a program as we possibly can to honor this great accomplishment in your life. And so if you would see Brother Crawford, he has some things he needs to talk to you about. Well, I had a great day yesterday. I got up early yesterday morning and got to spend all day long with Brother Anthony McCool, and we just had an awesome time. It was a beautiful day, and God blessed us with great weather. They were generating on a one in the river yesterday, which always is perfect to catch smallmouth bass. We got to play some golf after that, and then we went to a birthday party after that, and his wife said, I wore him out. But we just had a great time, and I've known the McCool family literally all my life. Since I was old enough to know anybody, I've known the McCool family. And I grew up, I've told this story many times, my aunt Debbie, my mother's sister, used to cut my hair when I was growing up. And she would say, how do you want me to cut your hair? And I said, like Mark McCool's. I've always looked up to Brother Mark McCool. He's been a mentor to me, an example to me. He's a great friend to me in good times and in difficult times. That's when you find out who your friends are. Amen. Everybody's hanging around. Everything's going good, Brother Larry. But it's when you face difficult situations and circumstances, look around, see who's still there. Amen. Whoever's still there, that's who your friends are. And Brother Mark McCool has been a great friend to me. Bishop McCool, just a hero and a legend and a modern-day apostle. You could go on and on and on talking about the greatness of these men, their wives. I don't know a classier lady in the world than Sister Betty McCool. She's just a classy person. And Sister Jamie has followed in her footsteps. You know, she's been that example to her. And Sister Ashley. Then comes along Sister Kelly, who we love so very, very much. And I call her Princess Di. Because when I see Sister Betty McCool, she gives me the little proper handshake. And Sister Jamie does, and Sister Ashley does. Well, I see Sister Kelly. Hey, Brother Loveless! I call her Princess Di. She's just awesome, and she fits right in with our bunch. Just good, down-to-earth folks, and we love her so, so much. And Brother Anthony, since he was just a wee lad, he and I at camp meeting every year, and his dad would go and play golf and fellowship, and he's a great example to young men that you don't have to get out in the world to have a testimony. That you don't have to blow it to have a testimony. We heard something about that Wednesday night, and we're thankful for those testimonies. I have one of those testimonies, but you don't have to blow it to have a great testimony. And what an example he's been to my sons. My sons have grown up looking up to him and his father just like I did. And he's a dear friend of mine. I love and appreciate him so very, very much. And what a preacher. He has blessed us. I remember last time he came here, there was a great move of the Holy Ghost in that service. There were folks in this altar that hadn't been up here in a while. I'm anticipating another great move of God here today. I'm going to ask you to stand, and would you put your hands together and welcome the man of God as he comes to bless us with the word, Brother Anthony McCullough.
Let's give that hand to the Lord, because he's the only one who is worthy. Give him a shout of praise that he is worthy of right now. Lord, Heavenly Father, in your name this afternoon. In Jesus' name. Jeremiah, as Pastor Loveless was saying, he said this word, the truth of this gospel has oftentimes gotten me in trouble with my friends. The place I live in, the community I reside in, they've shunned me. God, and I pray to you, am I doing the right thing? Am I in your will? I thought this is what you told me and commanded me to do. Have you deceived me, Lord? Have I been tricked? Have I wasted all of this time, all of the work? Have I been faithful for nothing, God? I told the truth, but everyone around me seemed to mock me and make fun of me, and they left me and abandoned me. God, I in my flesh, I said, I'm not going to speak about you anymore. I'm not going to preach about your name any further. But every time I tell myself I'm going to do this in my flesh, your word just screams inside of me. And it's like a fire shut up in my bones, burning and breathing and leading me. I don't know where you came, what circumstance you came here this evening, what you've been going through. I don't know what your background is or what your style of worship is that you're used to. But I will tell you this. I don't need the world or society to give me some philosophical assessment, if you will, on how my worship and my praise is relegated down to some display of emotionalism. I don't need mainstream and popular Christianity to give me some word and discourage me about how this is just some man-made tradition, and I don't like the term religion, and it's just a word you shouldn't use, and you shouldn't clap your hands and shout out a praise. You're just out of order when you do these things. The only thing that I need from this world and from this society is just to give me just a little bit of room while I praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's been too good to me. I don't base my praise, I don't base my relationship with Christ over the climate of this society. I'm going to worship Him, I'm going to celebrate Him, and I'm going to preach about the truth of the name of Jesus, regardless of what's going on around me. Clap your hands one more time for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name. You can be seated. What an awesome church body. What a packed house that is here tonight. I give honor tonight to this great and amazing assembly. Brother Ben Christian and that praise team. My goodness. There is so much talent in this church. This is a blessed church body. I find it ironic that a man with the last name of Christian is talking about my last name. That's even better. My wife gets on to me oftentimes when we're checking out somewhere or paying, they'll see my card and it says McCool, and they'll say, that's a cool name, and
I usually say if you'll replace the second C with an F, it's a little bit more applicable to me. Well, I did that the other day, and the guy continued to ring me up, and then he said, "Oh, I just got what you said," and he just started laughing, and laughing a little too much, you know, and it's like, and it's not that funny. But, yeah, but I honor you tonight, Brother Christian, and thank you for your ministry, and I feel like I can do anything up here when I've got Sister Christian over on the keys. She, if I start stuttering or messing up, she can just hit that note, and this place will start praising and worshiping. She is amazing, amazing, amazing. I want to give honor where honor is due tonight. One of my dearest friends in this world, Brother Jacob Loveless. I'm a little bit scared preaching in front of him. And all these men appear, some of my favorite preachers. He preached one of the most masterpiece of messages at our youth retreat a few years back. And if, I don't know about anybody else, but I feel like he preached it just to me. And I say that it was before I started working in the church full time. I always worked in the church, but I had another job and I was in school and I'd worked 40 hours that week and also had schooling to do, and the enemy, you know how he tells you, you don't have time to go to youth retreat. And I got off at work about 6:15, was supposed to get off work about 4 o'clock, got off work at 6:15, and of course, heading up to Pigeon Forge area on a Friday night, you all know what that's like. Just barely got into service, was tired, had to be at work the next morning. Church on Sunday, had to set up on that Saturday night for the youth that you're in charge of, and that would take a few hours because we didn't have a space yet. Just as the enemy tells you, you didn't have time to be there. Logic tells you didn't have time to be there, but I walked in, and it was right before Brother Jacob Loveless got up to preach, and half tired and all of the other things taking distractions in your life, and he just began to give his testimony about serving God and being a bivocational minister in the church. And he just poured out his heart and was so transparent and talked about how if you'll be faithful over a few things, God will make you ruler over many. And it just, I left out of that service with just a supernatural strength. And that sermon has just stuck with me through many different times in my life, and was also a pivotal point at a crossroads that I was in. And I thank him tonight for being used and led by God and for his ministry. One of my most dear friends in the world, Brother Chase Vickers. My goodness, this church is blessed. Only heaven will be able to account for the many students that he impacts, not only here in East Tennessee, but he's also our national P7 leader and just organizes and preaches all across this country, and every time I get on social media, he's here, he's there, he's preaching here, he's at this school. I want to be like Brother Chase, and I honor him tonight. Brother Mike Vickers, again, one of my favorite preachers. Yes, he's unbelievable. How our last rally, he preached about how big God is, and he talked about how the God of this universe who placed the planets into existence and the orbits, and he started talking about all these galaxies and comets and all these intergalactic stuff that I can't even comprehend, and just how big a God we serve. And then he broke it down to how that same God has such an intimate relationship with his creation that he has the hairs on your head numbered. And I was just like, man, I feel pretty good. That problem doesn't even really seem like a problem when I start thinking about how big God is. And I thank Brother Vickers tonight. Lastly, Pastor John, Sister Wendy Loveless, these are truly, truly heroes for me and so many others. Growing up in a pastor's home, I've had the opportunity to be around a lot of different preachers and ministers and pastors. There's nobody like Pastor Loveless. He's a celebrity when he goes out, even into the community. Everybody loves him. I've told him this before. Thank you for your example on how to interact with the world and the society around you. I know there's many times in his life where, like Peter defending Jesus, he could have pulled out his sword, and by the world standards, he had every right to, he had every justification to, but instead he chose a soft word and a comforting and loving voice. And he is just the epitome of what I aspire to be like as a minister into this world. His love is unconditional. He needs to just preach what he was preaching in the prayer room about the prodigal son, about when the prodigal son came home. I thank him for his ministry and his example to this generation. If you would stand in honor of your pastor and his wife tonight and give them a great big hand clap for all of the things they do behind the scenes, the many hours they spend praying, the many hours they spend worrying over your family. God, I thank you for the man of God tonight in your life. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Just remain standing. Again, you could have called a lot of people to preach to you tonight, and they would have been glad to be here and excited. But I promise you this, there is none of them that feel more honored and want to be here more than I do tonight. And I am so, so very thankful. I'm so honored and so feel so very blessed to have my beautiful and lovely wife, Kelly, with me. She's just like as you talked about, Brother Loveless. She's taken my ministry to another level, and people like her more than they like me. She's a better preacher than I am, a better writer. This past month, if anybody gets the apostolic witness, about 4 months ago, the gentleman that's over it texted me and said, "Hey, I want you to write an article for the witness." I'm like, "All right, you know, I put that bad boy together, and it was going to be checked every word, you know, those little green squiggly lines on. I made sure those were fixed, and as I went back through, there was a lot more red lines that I had to fix because I can't spell very well. But I had a couple people proofread it. My wife proofread it, and it was ready to go. It's going to really impact someone, you know. So we submitted that, and it was coming out in the witness. Well, about a week before that month was about to be published, my wife wrote a blog, and they contacted her about putting her blog entry in there. And I'm like, "That's great. We're going to have two articles in the witness at the same time. That's pretty awesome." Well, they came out, and hers is on the front cover, her title, and the front page. She's got about a 4 or 5 page spread, and my article is in the back in a box, and you have to get out a microscope, you know, to read it. And she's got people across the country and she put it online as well, messaging her like all these big long messages and confiding a lot of things in her and asking her for her advice. And and I'd go around, and a gentleman came up to me at church. He said, "Wow, I really enjoyed that apostolic witness this past month." I was like, "Well, you know, there's somebody I got to, you know, they found this." I was like, "Well, thank you. And he kind of looked stunned. He said, "Did you help your wife write that?" And I'm like, "No." But if anybody in here has that, it's in the back page. Just let me know what you think about it. But I'm so blessed to have her by my side tonight. Is anybody, I just feel at home tonight. Is that all right? Can we have church? I don't have some pretty sermon written out. I'm not that really a good a preacher. I just, whatever God gives to me, I just want to minister tonight and hopefully be where we are at with the Lord. If you've got your Bible, the book of Jeremiah, I've been talking about him already a little bit tonight, but go ahead and turn to verse 32. Jeremiah 32, and we're going to begin reading at verse number 8. I have a few scriptures here, so just hang with me just for a moment. Jeremiah 32, beginning at verse number 8. And this is Jeremiah talking. It says, "So Hanamel, mine uncle's son, came to me in the court of the prison, according to the word of the Lord, and said unto me, Buy my field, I pray thee, that is in Anathoth, which is in the country of Benjamin, for the right of inheritance is thine, and the redemption is thine. Buy it for thyself. Then I knew this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field of Hanamel, mine uncle's son, that was in Anathoth, and weighed him the money, even 17 shekels of silver. And I subscribed the evidence and sealed it and took witnesses and weighed him the money in the balances. He subscribed the evidence, he sealed it, he took witnesses and weighed him the money in the balances. So I took the evidence of the purchase, both that which was sealed according to the law and custom, and that which was open. And I gave the evidence of the purchase unto Baruch the son of Neriah, the son of Mahesiah, in the sight of Hanamel, mine uncle's son, and in the presence of the witnesses that subscribed the book of the purchase, before all the Jews that sat in the court of the prison. And I charged Baruch them, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these evidences, take this contract, take this legal document, this evidence of the purchase, both which is sealed, and also the evidence which is open, and put them in an earthen vessel, put them in a safe place, somewhere where they can't be ruined by moisture or fire, or they can't be stolen easily. Put them in an earthen vessel, a safe, that they may last and continue many days. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of the heavenly army, Brother Vickers, houses, fields, and vineyards shall be again possessed in this land. Say that with me one time. Houses, fields, and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. One more time. Houses, fields, and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. I'm talking about houses tonight that above the post that says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. I'm talking about houses tonight that one time said apostolic across them, but it's now been taken off. Houses, fields, and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. I'm talking about houses tonight that above the doorpost at one time it said, Be ye holy, for I am holy. Those are going to be again possessed in this land. Put your Bibles down. Let's pray over this sermon tonight. I'm going to be talking to you tonight about put your name where your faith is. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight. God, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to assemble together, to worship and lift up your name. God, we thank you for your word tonight. God, let it sink deep into our hearts. Lord, let us realize and recognize that the very same God that created this world is the very same God that has power in our situation. God, we serve a great big God. God, we magnify your name tonight. Whatever issue or need we have, we can call on the name of Jesus, and you're going to meet our needs. We turn this service over to you tonight in Jesus' name. Would you clap your hands one more time? And you can be seated here in the house. Houses, fields, and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Put your name where your faith is. Suppose a real estate agent called you and said, I've got a choice property for you. It's nestled in the mountains. It's a luxury hotel resort. It's got all of the amenities of a fine resort. It's five-star, you know. It's got spacious hotel rooms. An Olympic-sized swimming pool. I don't know how big an Olympic-sized swimming pool is, but when you hear that term, Olympic-sized, it's just, that's large. It's got that in it, you know. It's got a spa in it. It's not as nice as the First Lady Day Spa, but that's what we're shooting for, you know. That's what we're striving for. Everything on the entire complex is the epitome of luxury. The property itself is worth around $20 million, plus all of the facilities that I've spoken of. And it's appraised for that much, but for you, I'll let you have it for $20,000. Now, that sounds pretty good. Now, I couldn't just go get $20,000 easily, but there's some people I could call and put a team of investors together and probably come up with that $20,000, but I don't even think I would have to go to the bank to even try to get a loan. I could just call some people that would be ready, or maybe even one person, and they'd be ready to jump on that. And as I look over the deal and what's been given to me to purchase, appraised potentially at $20 million, all of these luxurious amenities, I scroll through it, and there's some fine print kind of down at the bottom, kind of like how my article was. Some fine print. Get your magnifying glass out to see it. And by the way, it's located. It's in the mountains, nestled beautifully in the mountains. But it's right on the border of Iraq and Syria. Don't let that get in the way of the deal. But buying property in a war zone would be a high risk investment. But to buy a piece of property that is already under the control of the enemy, when it's obvious that the enemy is on the verge of overthrowing the entire country, would be crazy. Yet that's exactly what God asked his prophet Jeremiah to do. Jeremiah was under siege, on brink of falling to the Babylonians. And Babylon is a type of sin in the Old Testament. When we read about the allusions even in the New Testament and the comparisons in the New Testament to Babylon and Egypt, Egypt is what we are freed from. But the difference between Egypt and Babylon, Daniel tells us in Daniel chapter 1, Babylon comes into Jerusalem. Babylon attacks you in the house of God. Babylon comes to you on the church pew and claims sovereignty and proclaims authority over you right in the house of God. Jeremiah was in prison already in his own country because he had been preaching that the nation was going to fall and that God wanted them to surrender. He was preaching that the nation better turn back to God or the Babylonians would besiege them. He was in bondage by his own countrymen, and he was in bondage not by Babylon yet, but by those that once believed as he did. He was in bondage for preaching the truth of the gospel. He was in bondage in his own country for doing the will of God. And Babylon was on the brink of besieging the entire country. Jeremiah was not a businessman or an investment banker. Jeremiah was not a man of significant financial resources. He did not have a Donald Trump-esque, if you will, aspiration for real estate development. But in a time when a foreign oppressor, not just any foreign oppressor, perhaps and arguably the most powerful empire ever to exist in humanity, was occupying the land, Jeremiah, we read, bought a field. This, in a modern context, this would have been a time when the financial structures would have collapsed as everyone attempted to liquidate their assets. Wall Street, if you will, had completely and utterly crashed. This would have sent investors running. Consumer spending and investment would have dropped. This would have caused steep declines in industrial output and rising levels of employment as failing companies would lay off workers. But we read that Jeremiah bought a field. The local economy, at the very least, would have been in a recession at this time. As consumer spending dropped and unsold goods began to pile up, slowing down production, those who were able to maintain a job would have seen a deep decline in wages. Buying power would decrease. And one, if you had anything left to your name, would be very wise to keep it as a means of bargaining power tucked away for the very basic essentials of life, especially if you're already locked up in a prison. But we read that Jeremiah bought a field. Now, some of you might be rationalizing with the situation and thinking, but it's real estate. Land is valuable. You could turn it over in a few years for a little bit of profit. The Babylonians were overtaking the land, and they were overtaking Israel's way of life as they know it, and that will be drastically changed forever by this foreign pagan oppressor. Soon the Babylonians would own all of the property. They would own all of the real estate. And this foreign oppressor would not recognize rights to property, and certainly Jeremiah's purchase would be absolutely worthless. But we read that Jeremiah bought a field. In fact, not only did Jeremiah buy this field, but in verse 10 we read that he went through all of the proper legal proceedings to complete the purchase. He signed and sealed the deed of purchase before witnesses. He weighed out the silver to ensure that it was the exact amount. He had a contract, and he also had witnesses. He said, put the deeds of sales into a pottery jar, into a safe, so that they may be preserved for a long time. The old prophet, he's lost it. He's been bound up in a prison for too long. The only sunlight he sees is when he passes by the steps at the heat of the day, when the sunlight just barely trickles down the steps. He's walking around shackled up all day long. He's lost it. This must be some type of dementia that has struck God's prophet. The Babylonians are conquering the land, and here comes Jeremiah's cousin to make a little bit of quick cash from the worn out and ringed out prophet. And we all have one of these cousins, you know. Don't try to guess which one is mine, but he's the kind of cousin that came down into the prison to see his Uncle Jeremiah, and he says he's the kind of cousin that opens up his jacket, you know, and he's got Folex and everything else trying to sell. He's selling everything he has so he can liquidate his assets, and whatever pennies he can make off of that property, he can hit the road because Babylon's on their way. Hey, Jeremiah, I know you're in prison here, but this is your inheritance. What a fantastic deal I'm offering. Have I got a deal for you? And the other prisoners in the jail cell, Jews, just like Jeremiah, they weren't very fond of Jeremiah to begin with because of his radical and fanatic preaching. But you know, they'd been hanging around him. They're probably a little bit sympathetic with him. Trying to talk some sense into the old prophet. Jeremiah, don't you know what it looks like out there? First off, your best days are behind you. Don't you know the people don't want to hear that type of preaching anymore? It's your gospel, Jeremiah, is offensive. Your gospel is not sensitive to this ever-changing society. Your words, Jeremiah, they're just not very pleasant to the masses. And you know, we've had our differences, Jeremiah, but are you really going to buy this land from your cousin? We all know your cousin. He's a con artist. He's a slime ball. We know he's your family, but he is selling you property that Babylon, at maybe by the end of this day, is going to own. He's just trying to deceive you. He just wants your last penny so he can split and be on your way. It's not your inheritance. He's just trying to sell everything he has so he can get out of town. And at least if you're going to buy it, Jeremiah, at least offer him half for it. Well, try to bargain him down a little bit of what he's selling it for. Don't spend your last dime on an old worthless field. Even if there wasn't a Babylon coming, Jeremiah, you're not going to get out of here in any kind of time to do anything with it. The old prophet's lost it. But are you thankful for a man of God tonight in your life who walks by faith and not by sight. Though bound up and shackled in prison walls, we see that the prophet Jeremiah has perfect vision. He doesn't even try to negotiate for a cheaper price. Somebody hear me tonight. However, he crosses every T and he dots every I to ensure that there is not one loophole in the contract. There's not one phrase that would potentially negate the deal. A contract that's not even going to be recognized by the rulers of this land. But he says, put this contract into jars of clay that it might preserve them. Put them away in a safe place. Why did Jeremiah do this? He said, for thus saith the Lord of hosts. He said, gather around, I want to tell you guys something. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses, fields, and vineyards are again going to be possessed in this land. Jeremiah made this transaction of faith that one day, in a time not known to him, a day he might never see, a day when a future generation would conquer the enemy and again own the land to them promised by God. The year was 1956. My grandparents were in a revival in North Little Rock, Arkansas at Bishop A.O. Holmes Church. My grandpa often says, if you're ever on your way to Texas, you can see that church in Arkansas. It's really large now. That'll sink in a little bit because I'm not sure anybody's ever on their way to Arkansas. But in North Little Rock, Arkansas, at Bishop A.O. Holmes Church, there was a woman that attended this church by the name of Koji Looper. And she would cook in the cafeteria at this church and also in the Christian school. And she was very intent on seeing her family saved. She had a son at the time who was stationed in Germany. And my grandpa, I heard him tell this story many times growing up through in different sermons. He said Sister Looper would sometimes fast 2 or 3 times a week and in succession praying for her son. And he said, as her testimony goes, one night she started to go to bed. And she said, she looked at that bed with the soft sheets and the soft pillow. And she said, I cannot go to bed in this comfortable atmosphere with the pillow and the sheets, knowing that if my son died tonight, that he would be rolling on the coals of hell for all eternity. So he said that night she made a vow and she went out behind her home and grabbed and found a large field stone that she would take into her home and she put it on a rug next to her bed. He said every night that her husband would go to bed, she would make her pallet in the floor with that stone being her pillow so that she would not be comfortable with the fact that if her son would die, that he would not be saved. And she laid her head on that stone and prayed night after night, week after week, and month after month. While everyone was comfortable in their bed, Koji Looper's sleeping arrangements were a rug and a field stone for a pillow. During the revival, my grandpa says, the last day on the Sunday, the church was having a Sunday school picnic. And my grandfather was preaching. And in the middle of his sermon, he says, a young soldier just kind of stepped in the backside of the auditorium. And the soldier walked down the left side into the front seat. He listened to him preach and they had a good service. And Sister Looper, he said, sat on his far right side. And he said when he gave the altar call, this soldier came down from his seat, walking down this left-hand side and up to the altar. And when he walked in, of course, he said this gave Sister Looper just the greatest smile. as she looked at him, as she thought he was in Germany. She didn't know he had made it to the States. And this was the greatest thrill to her. The young people, being anxious, went on to the picnic. But he said for 30, 45 minutes, an hour and a half, this young soldier prayed through after that revival and received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in another tongue. And the enemy had taken residence over his life, but because of a mother's determination, because of a mother's passion, it didn't make a lot of sense to go out and grab a field stone from the back. But she couldn't find herself comfortable night after night, knowing that her son was lost. She said, I just don't want to get comfortable. I don't want to get desensitized to the fact that my children and my child might be lost. And I heard this story many times growing up. But about 3 years ago, Brother Joel Holmes, Brother A.L. Holmes' son, is now the pastor. His wife had passed away, and my grandparents attended their funeral there in North Little Rock, Arkansas. And they had a reception following that they invited many of the ministers to. They were back there in the fellowship hall, going through the line to get whatever refreshments that were prepared. And my grandma struck up a conversation with the people in the cafeteria, and she said, my husband, we used to preach revivals here back in the 50s and 60s, and of course the people behind the counter probably didn't relate very well to that. And she said, just by any chance, he used to tell this story, and there was a woman in one of his revivals that gave her testimony, and we saw her son come to the Lord in the revival. Her last name was Looper. Her name was Sister Koji Looper. And when he said this, the woman behind the counter, tears began to just run down her face. And she said, it was one after the other. She said, I'm a Looper. And then she said, that's my grandmother. I'm a Looper. That's my great-grandmother. And of course, they just began to celebrate and rejoice. And she couldn't even get the rest of the story out. And she said, there was a young soldier, her son, that came home in one of the revivals. She said, that's my dad. And over there he sits. Generations affected. Generation after generation. All because somebody said, I just can't be comfortable knowing that my child's not saved. Because somebody went out and grabbed a field stone. It was a little bit unorthodox. But somebody said, houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Why don't you negotiate for the price just a little bit? I'm going to get me a field stone. This is going to be my bed here until my son comes home. Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. I just keep saying it over and over until it happens. Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Promise Church. Promise Apostolic Church. Many of us are living today out of gardens that we didn't plant. We find joy and are being merry in vineyards that we didn't grow. Heaven help us if we don't have the same determination and the desire and the passion as the generation before us. I declare every student in the house tonight, it's time to step up. It is time to step up. There has been a mighty road that's been paved for us. In Jesus' name. We're under the covering tonight of great men of God like Bishop Wilson and Bishop Peters and Bishop McCool. What was the price? What's the price you're willing to pay? How intent are you on seeing your family saved? How intent are you on seeing your school saved? How intent are you on seeing your coworker saved? What was the price, Jeremiah? You're going to pastor two different churches? Oh, Loveless has lost it a little bit. You're going to wear yourself out. Don't you know what it looks like out there? You're going to pastor two churches on, on a Sunday, two different Bible studies in the middle of the week, and you're going to serve in the local public school, and you're going to mow all these yards at the same time, Loveless has lost it. You'll never make it out there. It just doesn't make any sense. You can't grow a church in Church Hill, Tennessee. Why would you do that, Jeremiah? Why would you do that, Loveless? Don't you know what society is saying? Don't you know what modern-day Christianity looks like? There's never going to be people that listen that they need to live a holy life. There's never going to be people that come and get baptized in the name of Jesus. Have you lost it? Have I got a deal for you? I can see Brother Loveless in a prison cell like that. And you know how he just kind of nonchalantly puts those glasses up on his eyes, just so cool. I can see him pulling out a pen. This field might not mean anything to you. You might not see it now, but I can see Brother Loveless pulling out a pen and just saying, hey, where do I sign? And it wasn't some little small thing. I can see him writing a big old J, just as large as he can. By that field, by that high school, by that campus, by this field back here, where there will be an apostolic church in East Tennessee that preaches the truth of God's word. Brother Chase, you're going to go into these public schools and preach the gospel? That is laughable. Have you seen the news about all the school shootings, about the high suicide rates? You think they're ever going to listen to you when you get into those schools? Lost it. The enemy already has control. The enemy already has control over this community. Why would you buy a field here? Sure. You could have presented a more agreeable, socially accepted gospel in hopes of a quick, larger crowd. But there is no negotiation on the price. No negotiation on the cost. I often see and hear these stories about the generation before us and the great price they paid. And initially, I felt sympathy, but now I look up to them and see that these were mighty and strong warriors of God who said, bring on Babylon. We serve a great big God. You think I'm scared of Babylon? Because thus saith the Lord of hosts, houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Yeah, Babylon's come in and taken the hero Israel. The Lord our God has won off the door. But houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Yeah, they might take apostolic off the church name, but where do I sign? Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. There will be a holy people. There will be an apostolic church. I serve a great big God. I'm not negotiating on the price. There is not some compromise involved in this transaction. I'm going to dot every T and dot every I to ensure that there's not one loophole in the contract. We live in a society and in a culture that attempts to negotiate with Babylon on property rights. Again, I remind you, Babylon is the type and shadow of sin that attacks you while you are in Jerusalem. Sadly, many today are comfortable coexisting with Babylon. Sin and its deadly effects on the individual have become greatly ignored in favor of a message of all-inclusivism. Pluralism, postmodernism, and secularism are the church's replacement for repentance from and the true power of grace. Many churches today preach a lascivious form of grace. Churches have resorted to medical and legal paradigms to replace the realization and the magnitude of sin that affects the individual's life. Sin has been replaced with less offensive terms like pathology and recovery. But just one problem. That language is not in the book. It's apparent that the predominant message of many Christian denominations is now dumbing down sin to make it more palatable, to make it more accepting to the masses.
The language of sin is being replaced by political appropriateness in the pulpit. The reward of a larger congregation by using less offensive terminology when identifying specific sins has become trendy polemic presentation. But listen to me tonight. Disregarding the recognition of sin only diminishes the power of grace. For how can we preach about how powerful grace is if we do not identify the sin that this grace covers? Would you give the Lord a hand clap? I want you to start thinking tonight about that field that you're going to buy. It might be a person. It might be a situation. You might literally need to write your name to a check tonight. But like Jeremiah and the generation before us, Promise Church, we will not compromise. Whatever the cost is, that's what we are going to pay. We will deliver our gospel with love, and it could cost us our earthly freedom. But before witnesses, we will not waver on the doctrine of repentance, the baptism in the name of the one that died for us, the name of Jesus, and receiving His Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in another language. It's not for sale. We'll preach it in Church Hill. We'll preach it in Kingsport. We'll preach it in Johnson City. We'll preach it in Asheville. There will be an apostolic church in East Tennessee. I get excited when I hear that. Though the enemy might have taken over our schools, I can walk it and look it right in the face and say, houses, fields, and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Though my family might have turned away, though loved ones might have turned away, I'm going to write my name over them tonight and say, houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. I'm not going to be comfortable until my family comes home. I'm not going to be comfortable until my loved ones come home. I'm not going to be satisfied until I baptize my coworker. I'm not going to be content until I see my school safe. Yeah, Babylon's come in. Yeah, there's a lot of sin in this world, but we serve a great big God. And the Lord told me to tell you to go ahead and get your pen out tonight. And whatever the situation is, say houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Shout for just a moment. He's going to do it. If you'll put your faith in Him, put your name where your faith is. What is it you want to see happen tonight? If you're a student under the sound of my voice, you ought to proclaim a couple things tonight. You ought to get your heart right first, because your salvation and your relationship with God is not just about you. There is somebody else. There's a generation to come that is dependent upon your walk with God. Musicians, please come. Jesus tells us in the book of Matthew that the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. We're talking about buying a field. We're talking about putting your name where your faith is. I wonder if somebody tonight will exude the faith like Jeremiah had, like Pastor Loveless has. It might seem irrational. It might seem illogical. It might not make sense to the standard of thinking to this world. But I wonder if there's a field somebody would like to buy tonight. What is that field? Is it a lost son? Is it a lost daughter? Is it a lost loved one? Maybe it's a group of people that's turned away from this gospel. The Babylon's crept in unaware. Changed some things. But I'm going to write my name over them tonight. I'm going to love them. Where do I sign at? Houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. God told the king through Jeremiah that if Israel tries to fight, that they will lose. Only with God in control
will they be able to defeat Babylon? Listen to me tonight. If you rely on your talents, if you rely on your ability, if you rely on your thinking to try to fix your situation, to try to bring a lost loved one home, it's only going to work by putting God in the driver's seat. Would you stand with me this evening? What's that field look like tonight? I want you to, as we pray in just a moment, why don't you go ahead and close your eyes? How intent am I today on seeing my family saved? What is it I'm going to do to show God that I'm desperate? I need my son to come home. I need my daughter to come home. I need my family to come home. The Lord of hosts means He is the captain of the heavenly army. Somebody needs to get their pen out today and say, houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. Pastor Loveless told us in the prayer room before service, he started talking about the prodigal son. Every single day, the prodigal son would, the father would get his servants and he'd say, you go start preparing this robe. I want you to shine that ring. Why don't you go ahead and have those shoes ready? Chef, why don't you just be prepared? When my son comes home, we're going to have a great feast and a celebration. Day after day, week after week, the son hadn't come home. And no doubt some of the servants, they were murmuring like, he's lost it. We've been doing this for months. And the son, there's still no sign of the son. But every day he made a contract. He said, I'm not negotiating on this. Every single day I'm prepared for my son to come home. Though the enemy is overtaking him right now, I know that I've been promised by the Almighty God that houses and fields and vineyards will again be possessed in this land. And he said, servant, this is my home. I have dominion over this property. I don't want to hear another word of doubt. I want you to go get that robe prepared. I want you to shine that ring. And I want you to get the feast ready, because this is the day that my son's coming home. And just like that, one day, just probably real small, real faint, the father's just sitting out front. And he sees an image just getting closer and closer. And that image kind of had the demeanor of his son, you know. As he starts walking, that kind of looks like my boy right there. And often I've heard it preached that the son walked up to the into the household. I bet his father was... who just went sprinting as fast as he could. And he said, he had his arms wide open. And he said, I love you, boy. You're my son. And he couldn't get fast enough to get that ring back on his finger, because it was a signet ring. That ring gave him authority over the household. He said, this is all yours. And the son's probably like, now I'll work in the fields a little bit and work my way back up. He said, No. This is your household. This is your property. Your name is over this land. This is your land. And that shows us what it looks like when our son or our daughter comes home. There's no step-by-step process that they have to do in terms of restoration. God's mercy and God's grace is new every single morning. There's no diminishing return on God's love. If you're under the sound of my voice tonight and you're battling, am I going to feel accepted if I take a step forward in my walk with God, 100 times yes. This is a church that loves you. And it's time to come home, because it's not just about you. There's people at your school. There's people in your workplace. You're going to have sons and daughters one day. You're going to have grandchildren one day that are dependent upon the decision that you make tonight. As we pray right now, Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight. God, as somebody battles a decision tonight to take a step forward, God, I ask you to give them strength. God, give them vision. Give them the courage tonight. Lord, somebody under the sound of my voice is proclaiming authority over some different things in their life. They're taking the pen out tonight and saying, I'm putting my name on that by faith, knowing that houses and fields and vineyards are again going to be possessed in this land. In Jesus' name right now. I wonder if somebody would boldly step forward tonight and step up to the altar and say, I'm putting my name down tonight. I'm declaring it to be so tonight. I don't know what that situation is, but I wonder if somebody would step forward tonight. It might be the new church going up. It might be a lost loved one, but I'm stepping forward tonight saying houses and fields and vineyards are again going to be possessed in this land. I'm not listening to the enemy tonight. Yeah, Babylon's coming in and they're a big army. Yeah, my friends and my family have shunned me and locked me up. But houses and fields and vineyards, houses and fields and vineyards, I declare it to be so. Houses and fields and vineyards.